Salutations, everyone. My name is Allan Aldroid, and did I scare you? Do you mind if you let me in? I've lost the key to my room, and this guy down there doesn't seem to be very happy about me calling him unfunny, and he's out to get me. So would you just mind letting me? Oh, come on, please. Come, he's right. Oh, right.
Well, I guess it's the worst place to end up after receiving a comical blow to the head.
At Dead of Night is part horror film, part horror game, and part ghost hunt. And I love it. The story, the style, the gameplay, it's something I haven't seen from a horror game before. And I absolutely adore it. It's an experience like no other. This game, to be honest, didn't seem like something that would pique my interest to begin with. It's a point-and-click 3D-ish styled horror game set in a small old British hotel where you explore rooms and try not to see blunt force trauma from someone who looks like a Pennywise or Matt Smith did the unthinkable and were then given the unfortunate job of being so unfunny people died around them. I was never really a fan of point-and-click games. I don't hate them, I just never played one that I was interested in. The only ones I played were some educational ones on the school computers or FNAF, so it's fair to say I haven't had much experience with them. That being said, I saw a video come up on my YouTube recommended page of the opening cutscene. No more, no less. It piqued my interest from the thumbnail, being live action compared to the rest being rendered by a computer it seemed. That alone was enough to get me to click on the video and watch the opening cutscene from its style. And from there, started my descent into the horror of Sea View Hotel. Slight spoilers ahead. The story begins with the main character Maya being ditched by her friends in the middle of the forest because of plot convenience. They ring Maya and tell her to go check in at the Sea View Hotel along the road. Upon checking in, you meet Jimmy, the hotel proprietor. He tells you that not only are your friends already checked in, but he's also very funny. Maya, not a fan of funny people, declines his invitation to watch his comedy routines, which turns him from Discord nice guy to Discord moderator, and kidnaps all of Maya's friends. Maya, running away after what she's seen, finds an old wooden steampunk looking box which allows you to talk to ghosts. The screen fades to the long, dark corridors of the hotel, Jimmy's personal labyrinth that you're trapped in. Words float and fade onto the screen. Sea View Hotel has a dark past. Its ghosts have a story to tell, but Jimmy must hide the truth. The cutscene ends and fades into gameplay, and the nightmare begins. Except
now, I really like this game. I really do. But isn't there something wrong here? You have Maya witnessing her friends get drugged and dragged away by some madman in a hotel, and the first thing she decides to go, "Oh, look, a funny box! I wonder what it does!" Ah!
All jokes about my problem aside, I really like this opening. From the get-go, you're thrown into the adventure in a style that we haven't seen a horror game adopt in recent times. Is this the first ever game to be a point-and-click FMV horror adventure?
No.
But this is a game that uses the concept in a way that I personally haven't seen in a long while. Like FNAF and DDLC, this game stood out from its style alone from the beginning. The acting is amazing, and the live-action opening is just so beautiful to look at. Well, that's enough of that. We'll get to the game style later.
So, Maya has her objective clearly given to her from the get-go. Find her friends, uncover the truth, and get the heck out of this hotel. Simple, effective, and easy to understand. I'll try not to get into too much detail about the story. I highly recommend that you go there and play it for yourself. So I'll do my best to summarize it, but unfortunately there will be some spoilers, so be warned.
You start the game trying to find a scrying mirror and a compass, because you're going to need that to find your objectives and look into the ghost realm. You know, information everyone knows. The game is split into separate acts where you get to talk to ghosts haunting the halls of the hotel and try to avoid Jimmy from giving a mild case of blunt force trauma. In the game, you'll encounter four separate ghosts: Amy, Dr. Bose, Harvey, and Rose, Jimmy's mother. The stories these ghosts tell are all written beautifully and tied together pretty well to help paint a picture of Jimmy's life, all the while keeping some mystery still lurking about him. In the game, when you reach certain parts of the hotel, you'll encounter cutscenes telling the stories of the four characters. The way you interact with them does come under gameplay, so I'll talk a little bit more about it in that section, but I'll try and give a rundown of what I love about these stories. They are really well acted. Talking to the ghosts and watching them interact with the environment is really mesmerizing due to the style of the game. The live action bits don't stay for too long, keeping their uses effective. You'll mainly talk to them through the spirit receiver and have them recount their experiences with Jimmy too, which isn't as boring as you might think. They are a nice change of pace from the stealthy hiding from Jimmy gameplay, which helps them stand out in my opinion. My favourite story out of all of this, however, is Dr. Bose's. Everything from the acting, the tone, his voice, and his role in the story was absolutely amazing and helped show off the psyche of Jimmy when he was a lot younger. What I liked about this story is that it was shown that Jimmy's mother, Rose, actually tried to help her son and could see there was something wrong with him. One trope I never liked in a horror story is when the antagonist is all evil and erratic while their mother's like, "Oh, he's just a sweet day. He must have accidentally slipped while he was holding the gun and shot Justin Bieber 57 times. This wasn't the clip I was actually looking for, but it'll do. This story shows both Jimmy and Dr. Bose's character in such an intriguing and engaging way. And Dr. Bose not giving up on Jimmy after he serves him a flipping glass sandwich is oddly touching. He keeps the bloodstained rag as evidence, sure, but he tries to stay and help out Jimmy. He's a good man trying to help a mentally ill child, but it ultimately becomes his downfall. That's what I love about these stories. They're there to build up Jimmy's past, but each character doesn't feel like they're there to just serve as backstory for him. They feel real and weave seamlessly together in subtle ways. Harvey starts out his story talking about Dr. Bose and what happened to him. Rose called Dr. Bose to help Jimmy's erratic behavior from how he treated Amy and so forth.
This game story flows in a way that just feels right. None of the stories overstay their welcome, except for one, maybe, but I'll talk about that later. What I hate about games is when certain storylines or bits just feel like they just take forever to complete, going round and round in circles, trying to explain something you already knew, or just end up becoming a downright bore to play, just dragging the game down, just making it unfun to play.
Now, while the story holds up, it needs to be balanced with good gameplay. You don't want to play something absolutely horrible just to see a decent story. So, how well does the gameplay hold up? It's pretty good. Fine, I'll elaborate. At Dead of Night's gameplay is really simple at heart. Uncover the ghost stories, try not to get thwacked, rinse and repeat. While this game is technically free roam, movement is pretty restrictive. You can only move to set points on the map. However, despite these limitations, what you can do in this game is pretty in-depth. Stuff like peeking through keyholes and spyglass to see if Jimmy's on the opposite side of the door are really nice details to help you figure out where he is, as well as being able to listen to certain audio cues, such as the unnerving are really immersive and play infrequently enough so that the fear factor from hearing them doesn't die out over the game's runtime. They play just enough to keep you on your toes and are valuable to figuring out Jimmy's whereabouts. Jimmy's AI is actually pretty good for a point-and-click game. It helps when you can look and see him walk past or hide behind the walls. Unfortunately, you won't be able to see him running at Mach 10 towards you due to it being all pre-recorded clips, but it still gives off the right tension as you see a shadow on the floor or him hide behind a corner. There were some times where I thought my bonkings were a bit unfair, to be honest. I got my head caved in because Jimmy just so happened to be by the first floor staircases that one time when I walked out, but most of the time the AI felt like Jimmy was really walking through the hotel and you can actually figure out his movement patterns. But does this mean the controls are perfect?
No.
There has been some times where I'm running away from Jimmy and I'll miss my turning or a dodge by overshooting, which can get annoying sometimes. Other times I'll be going, "Alright, I want to go down here. No, down here. The amount of times I've accidentally called out to Jimmy is a lot, however I don't know if it's because of the controls or my stupidity. Yeah, it's the controls. And then there's the second part of the gameplay, the ghost hunting. Throughout your amazing escapades around the hotel, you'll come across items that you can use when talking to ghosts and question them on what they are, such as drawings, a wire, and a gun. A gun.
Well, why didn't you take the damn gun? Maya?
When you see a spooky sighting around certain parts of the hotel, a ghost will be available for you to interrogate about their tales. In these bits, you have to ask the ghost if they know about certain items, and if they do, link it to the story beat with the correct item. I was actually very fortunate during my playthrough to get a lot of the items I need to talk to the ghost when I was exploring for a compass and scrying mirror, and I'd highly recommend this style of gameplay because I didn't have to worry about Jimmy so much having to go backwards and forwards trying to find a certain item needed to progress the story. However, if there are a few items that you don't have to progress the storyline, that's okay. You can use the scrying mirror to find out where the next ghost sighting will be or key item, at the expense of Jimmy being a lot more alert and also coming straight for you. Did this make the game not fun to play? No, not at all. I still enjoyed it a lot. It didn't take anything away from the experience, and I still heavily enjoyed my time with this game. And the atmosphere and style of it was something I also absolutely adored. Speaking of which, holy hell, this game does it so well! The soundtrack, if you can call it that, is a mixture of eerie low tones and ambience noises which fits so perfectly with the tone of the game. They help make the hotel feel haunted as you traverse its winding corridors. The grating strings that play when you come to contact with ghost sighters make you jump in surprise, but aren't loud and in your face enough to attempt to give you a cheap scare. Jimmy's sound design. Ho! Oh. Jimmy's sound design. It is so good! The game was made by Tim Follin. You know, that Tim Follin. The one responsible for the best NES tracks out there for games. So it's no surprise that his sound design is so good. Every time you see him walk past, he's accompanied by these high-pitched violin strings that help you feel uncomfortable and put you on edge. The atmosphere created is top-notch. Jimmy is such a cool and intriguing horror villain in my opinion. Seeing him walk past or call out to you is so freaky and I adore it. Jimmy is a lot better at evoking fear into the player compared to other horror game villains. While they try to feel real through their photorealistic art style or amazing AI, Jimmy feels real because he is real. Jimmy isn't computer generated. He's played by a real person, being acted out beautifully by the wonderful and talented Huld Martha. Their acting is absolutely stunning and helped create the horror villain that is so memorable in my eyes. From the creepy callings from around the corner to seeing his silhouette check the room you're in to the jump scare thwacking, it's all just so perfect in my eyes and they did a wonderful job bringing the psychotic murderer alive. All the acting in this game is flipping amazing and definitely one of the highlights to this masterpiece. However, the people who stood out to me personally was Rohit Gokarni as Dr. Bose, no surprises there, and Joanna Bond as Rose. This isn't trying to knock any of the other actors as well, they were all absolutely phenomenal in this game. Carl Hayes as Harvey was absolutely stunning, seeing him at odds with Jimmy and trying to fight back, as well as Daisy Follin as Amy, a great segue character and story into Jimmy's characterization. I've explained why I like Gokarni as Dr. Bose previously, so I'll explain why I love Joanna Bond as Rose. As the final story, it perfectly ties the game together in a neat little bow, and is really creepy and such a saddening tale performed beautifully through the live action and voice work, and the story adopted some very creepy surreal imagery that wasn't seen before in other stories. I won't show them off here because it's much more effective if you experience it yourself and you don't see them coming. Same with the ending, it's absolutely amazing and a great test of everything you've learned in such a tense sequence that I will also not go into too much detail. Play the game yourself, dummy.
And there we have it, ladies and gentle gamers, at Dead of Night, and why I think it is a masterpiece. Definitely a game horror fans should try out. It was certainly a lot of fun. Overall, I give this game a 3 out of 10. Maya, why did you take the flipping gun?